college from Wairu. Today I've got Sarah and Steph both, the author of Night Swimming. We're going to do an interview with you today and we've got some questions ready, so let's get started.
Yeah, we're super excited. Thank you so much for joining us.
First off, do you want to tell us about Night Swimming?
Okay, Night Swimming is basically about a girl called Kirby who lives in a small town that she loves on a goat farm where they make goat swim, so with her mum and her grandfather. And then a whole lot of things happen in her life that complicate everything. Finds out where her estranged father has been for years. Crop circles start showing up around town, and also a beautiful new girl arrives in town. Both she and her friend start to help her.
Sounds like a lot of things go on.
Yes, we both enjoyed reading it, so yeah, we really enjoyed that. And you've written two other books as well. What are those ones about?
My first novel, Girl Saves a Boy, is about a girl saving a boy from drowning, and then the sort of adventures and hijinks that ensue from that, and they both have to see that, so lots of mysteries there. And then the second one, August for Them, is about a girl who robs banks with her parents, pretty much. So it's obviously heavily based on my own life.
Yeah, of course.
No, not at all, but yeah, so it's a bank robbery novel, but it's also a contemporary life.
Right,
that's
what really you know.
Yeah, exactly. First of all, what are you reading at the moment?
I just finished reading A Shadow's Breath by Nicole Hayes, which was amazing.
Oh, I love it.
And I think it's really important that no one knows anything about it before they read it. I think you need to come to it not knowing anything.
Even the blurb is so vague.
And then I'm just about to start reading The Other Side of Summer by Emily Gow, which I'm really excited to read.
I really enjoyed writing
it. Yeah. So when you were first published, you were only 16. What was the experience like?
It was really surreal and exciting. I think when I started sending work out to agents, I didn't expect like heaps and heaps of rejection, maybe years and years, and then sort of all of a sudden everything just happened. So it was really surreal and really nerve-wracking for me because I was a little bit shy as a teenager, but it was awesome. Like, when I got to have so many really cool experiences as a teenager, I would write
books. So going back to Night Swimming, Kirby says, I like my science cracked and my books well loved. How do you like your books?
I like my books with the spines not cracked. I like them just very neat. I don't want the corners folded down. I want them to be in beautiful, mint condition, lined up nicely on the shelf. That's
how
my idea.
How do you feel about people out here in their books?
I mean, if it's their books, they're allowed to do that, but I think it shows a little bit of disrespect to
the books. It does.
To be honest, I think you need to treat it with the gravitas it deserves.
Exactly. Yeah. Respect it for
Night Swimming deals with quite a lot of complex and heavy issues, including sexuality, dementia, and mental illness. Are any of these particular topics very important to you?
Well, I decided to write about Kirby's grandfather having dementia after someone in my family was diagnosed with dementia. So that was something that was really close to my heart, and something I wanted to explore is something that so many young people deal with, and it's really confronting to see someone sort of losing aspects of who they are. So that was really close to my heart. And also in terms of things like sexuality and mental illness, also race, which I sort of started to explore in the book. I think it's really important to me increasingly to represent diversity, because I think there's this sort of tendency for the default characters of the white, cisgender, and straight, and all these things, and that doesn't represent reality at all. That's just sort of this skewed reality we have in the books.
Yeah.
So I really wanted to consciously sort of include things that, you know, represent a broader variety of young people.
Do you think you would have written about dementia in your record and diagnosis, or do you think it would have straight?
It's hard to know, I think, because it's really difficult to sort of determine what aspects of your own life and things you're writing because, you know, that's affected you, or because it's something that you're interested in and curious about. So it's really hard to say. I might have written about it, I might not, but I think I wrote about it in a truer way because I had first-hand experience of it, and it was something that was important for me to represent.
Yeah.
So most people that have read Night Swimming will know that it's set in a small Australian town. So why did you choose to write in that town set?
I love that in Australian fiction, I feel like there's lots of books set in Melbourne and Sydney, and then there's also lots of books set rurally.
Yeah.
But I feel like sometimes it's a really homogenous sort of rural Australia, and also sometimes they're really grim, like it's always really depressing. Whereas I wanted to create this small town that was sort of had diversity and was more representative of reality and a really hopeful and uplifting story. And I also, like, I love small town, I love road trips all throughout my childhood, so I it's so much fun writing this sort of creating your own little town and populating it with all these people. It's much more fun.
I love the restaurants in it.
And one of the things we loved about
light swimming.
One of the things we loved about night swimming. Well, spoiler alert. One of the things I loved about night swimming was how simultaneously heavy and light the novel was. How did you manage to keep the balance between the novel?
I think the really important thing was Kirby's voice, because a lot of the humour in the story sort of comes from her, but also the inclusion of Clancy as a character, because Clancy, even though he has depth, he's also like incredibly melodramatic and troublemaker, and he has he adds a lot of comic relief. So sort of having sort of Kirby's voice and Clancy as a character and having, you know, some sort of comic events to counterbalance the serious issues was really important. But I think I sort of naturally am drawn to writing things that are more humorous. So even if I'm dealing with serious issues, there's sort of really that humorous random
it's
important, especially in young adult fiction and in fiction in general. Like, there's enough books that are really grim and depressing. Mm-hmm. I want to be writing things that deal with real issues, but ultimately, you know, you're really feeling folks, you know, like, the world is terrible.
Yeah.
Because I feel like there's so many
books. Yeah, I have enough of those.
Yeah, I agree. Just need that comfort relief. Yeah.
Exactly. So I think we can all agree that there's something really unique and special about Aussie writing.
Yes.
So how do you think living in Australia has shaped how you write? And do you think you'd ever write something set in another country?
It's really tricky to say how living in Australia has shaped what I write, because I've never lived anywhere else. So I haven't travelled a lot. I think that I think reading American young adult fiction compared to Australian young adult fiction, I think the really wonderful thing about reading and writing Australian YA is that it can reflect particular cultural things that we have here, and that makes it sort of more realistic to us, because a lot of American things, you know, we're more familiar with from TV and movies, so it's sort of everything seems slightly false sometimes. But I think I would, if I'm grown up somewhere else, I'd probably write my book set somewhere else. And I think I would only write a book set in another country if I knew it really well, and I could sort of portray it in a way that's sort of accurate and doesn't misrepresent it. I'd love to write more books set in fictional worlds, but still, you know, have an Australian sort of flavour to them underneath it all.
Yeah, I really feel like the culture is definitely really different from Australia compared to, say, America, and the way that we read those books is, like, vastly different.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's really great to be able to read Aussie YA and know the references and the places.
Like when you're talking about the like Miss Lollies, like the ratio, I'm like, yes. Then you're like, dissing Musketeers, and I was like, excuse me?
That's my favourite one.
I'm so sorry.
Can't believe this.
It's not me, it's Kirby.
Kirby, we don't have to talk any to you. So that's all we have for reading questions. But we are going to be doing the lightning round. So basically, five last questions.
Yep.
You just say the first thing that comes to your head.
Okay, I'm ready.
Yeah.
I don't speak any other language, so I hope so.
We're going to give you 1 minute, and we have 20 questions, and let's see if we can answer all 20 in the 1 minute.
Yep.
So we'll set a timer.
Okay.
Alright.
Are you ready?
Ready, set, go.
Favourite book?
The Feeding Room.
Favourite food?
Pizza.
Favourite goat?
Stanley.
Favourite book you've written?
Night Swimming.
Favourite character in your novels?
Clancy.
Top three Aussie books?
I already said Graffiti Moon, I'm going to say Cloudwish, and I'm going to say Lorinda.
Nice.
Favourite colour?
Purple.
A writer who inspired you?
Melina Marquette.
Favourite season?
Spring.
Favourite movie?
Oh, this is so hard. Memento?
Oh, that is a good one.
Yeah.
Okay. Favourite TV show?
Community.
Favourite band or singer?
The Killers.
Best book to movie adaptation?
Fight Club.
What's your Hogwarts house?
Ravenclaw.
Favourite classic novel?
J.N. An overrated book?
Overrated? Twilight.
Favourite ice cream flavour?
Peppermint.
Best book you've read this year? That's time!
Best book I've read this year, I'm going to answer it anyway. I'm going to say... it's so hard. Because I just read... Shadow's Breath. I'm going to say Shadow's Breath because it's still in my head and I'm still like impacted.
So fresh, That was a brilliant one. We only had three questions left, so that was really great.
it's so hard when it's like, I'm going to quickly. And I feel like I want to revise my answers.
And we want to like reply to your answers.
Yeah. It's like, let's discuss.
Yeah. We just wanted to ask you one last question. If there was one message you want people to take from Night Swimming, what would it be?
I think the main message I want people to take from Night Swimming would probably be that it's okay to be a weirdo. I think there's this really wide spectrum of being a person journalist, specifically being a young person, and I hope that, you know, Night Swimming is sort of uplifting and like it's okay to be weird and different and out there. Like, everyone in the novel is a bit weird and it's all totally okay and normal and awesome.
I really like
it's
that.
It's okay to be weird.
Yes.
It is. New life, weird crowd. Well, thank you so much for joining us, and we also want to thank Vegan Books for allowing us to film our video here. We're really thankful for that. And yeah, we hope you have an amazing rest of the time that you have in your
life. And we can't wait to see you at the
launch. Yes!
We're going to begin the new level of my anthology, so I think it's very exciting. Yeah. But yeah, that's all we have for today.
Bye, everyone!